If you're a fan of the Sly Guy podcast and you want a little bit more slyness in your weekly diet, head on over to patreon.com/, you guessed it, Sly Guy podcast, where you can get the bonus guest episode every single week. As well as that, you get an extra Sly Guy podcast every Monday in audio-only format. Plus, you get dog walks with Davey, other things as well. My stand-up special from last year, not bits and pieces, but Pillow Talk, it's there too. And this week is going to be the first trial episode of a potentially new podcast called The Psychic and the Stand-Up, which is with me and Psychic Glenn, where we talk to guests, and it's going to be out this Friday. So if you want to see that for as little as £2 a month, head on over to patreon.com/SlyGuyPodcast. Guys, the time is upon us. The live Sly Guy podcast in the Strand Arts Centre is on Friday, the 24th of June. So if you're listening to this podcast on a Thursday, the 23rd of June, or on Friday, the 24th of June, you can go if there's any tickets left. There's the last little handful available, but if you listen after that, you'll have missed out on what will no doubt be a memorable evening. It's myself, Micky Bartlett, Ciaran Bartlett, and guests doing some stand-up and doing wee bits and bobs as well. It's a load of fun. The ticket link is in the description of the video. If you haven't already, if there's any tickets left, get on it now. Guys, I'm bringing my brand new show, Bits and Pieces, to the famous Ulster Hall on Saturday, the 10th of September, 2022. It's a brand new hour stand-up. It's my strongest hour yet. I can't wait. Tickets are available. They're available in the link below. Don't miss out. Get yourself there. We'll have some fun together, and you can be the ones to say, I was there the night that Davey did his best ever show. I love Davey. I'm so embarrassed I said that, but get tickets anyway. The Sly Guy podcast is brought to you in association with Modest Beer. Modest are an independent brewery who started out right here in Hollywood, County Down. Then, as luck would have it, they succeeded, they did well, they expanded, they moved to new premises, but their heart and soul is still here in Hollywood. And tell you what, they are also brilliant at making beer. Fuck their heart and soul, they make delicious beer. Modest Beer is the shit. And if you haven't tried Modest Beer yet, what's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? Get onto their website, www.modestbeer.co.uk. Check out some of their sweet merch over there. It's modest, it's understated, it's stylish, it's summer, it's chic. Get yourself some merch, then get yourself a lock of beers and just ring in the summer in the right way. Give them some support by following them on social media as well. On Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, the handle is simple, the handle is modest, the handle is at modest beer. Guys, check them out and enjoy the podcast.
I'm the Slack Guy.
Not a big fan of up the rah, that's a phrase.
As someone who's brought up in a Protestant estate, yeah. I quite like it.
Nice, do you use it regularly?
It depends what kind of company I'm with.
Yeah, I got mugged off so hard with up the rah actually recently too, because I was like, I don't want to say it because, you know, because I'm a mixed guy, I'm from a mixed marriage, everyone out there, I love Catholics and Protestants, I'm a future guy. Just call it, this is the episode, future guy. I'm a future guy and it is what it is, but I thought I would change it because obviously Ra rhymes with other things, and like, you know me, all he fucking talks about is being a dad, a boring snore, but I thought I'd just go up the da.
Yeah, there you go.
And then I did that and someone was like, is that UDA? And I went, oh no, no. Gotta be careful. No, I'll just not be up anything. I'll just be up myself. I'll just be up myself, and then that's it. So
yeah, I have you were saying there, like half Catholic, half Protestant.
I think you said half Catholic. Don't use that phrase. Don't.
Yeah,
that's,
you can't use
not
that
appropriate anymore. Yeah.
Sorry, half Protestant, half Catholic. Yeah. Then I literally, like, the term mongrel stock is the best way to describe me.
I thought you were just going to go, I just fucking hate you guys. You're going to be listening, you know. See, when you say you're mixed, I am just Protestant. Fuck you.
Yeah, it's I'm like, a thoroughbred. No. Yeah. So my granny was Jewish and my granda was Catholic.
Wow.
And for some reason,
oh, DP hit them.
I know, right? But then my mum ended up Presbyterian for some reason. I don't understand.
She must be like, I need to make right the wrongs of our past. I need to resolve this, and I need to resolve it soon. But yeah, it's weird to be in that. And you know, I sort of thought I was quite, you know, forward thinking, and like, because again, hey, I'm just, listen, I'm like a hip, my parents were the opposite hippies, but Nazis, but they were just like, always me, never worry about that, you know. And like, only now that I'm in comedy, I'm like, it's like being, you know, in Spider-Man, where like, with great power comes great responsibility. It's like, I have the power, I can say anything I really
yeah,
within reason, and then, you know, get away with it. So my guest on the podcast this week is Jordan Robinson. Welcome. I didn't give you any introduction there, and we're just straight into the chat. So how's the form anyway?
I'm fantastic, man.
Can I say I feel a little bit guilty getting you on the podcast today, because it's potentially the greatest day of the year.
I have literally been up for like, what time's it now? Like seven hours or something like that?
Nice. What's 1:15? What time is that?
Well, like I was up at seven, got showered, and... it may not be 7 hours, I don't know.
Yeah.
But, I've had, like, a real productive day already.
Good, because, I mean, No, you can correct me if I'm wrong here. I am very much a guy that likes to stand on the higher ground when it comes to early mornings. I call myself openly the morning man, the future man. I'm just... But I love the fucking mornings. I love them. And you strike me as the kind of guy, you know, I mean, I'd say you don't see many mornings.
That would be my opinion.
I would look at you like, he's a late night guy.
I am a night owl.
He's a late night guy.
I'm not a great sleeper either, but I'm not grouchy when I wake up. I'm just like, right, once I wake up, and I don't normally drink, like, I'm not one of those people that has to have, like, two cups of coffee or something like that.
I mean, just also, you know it's a hot day, because, what, is this a cold brew?
Cold brew, yeah.
Because Papa's on the cold brew. But what's weird, normally just a wee coffee, you can sip it on this. You're like, tell me your story. So you're a late night guy?
Oh yeah, 100%. I think that it goes hand in hand with doing stand up, I think.
Yeah, well, I'm like Margaret Thatcher. I like 3 hours sleep. I'm like Tom Smith. You know, I'll be awake. I'll be working 22 hours in the day, maybe sleep 6 hours, and then start the next day. But yeah, that's that. I think as I've got older, I've become more of a morning guy. Definitely. Like, I actually remember the moment I became a morning guy. I went to the gym before work whenever... is years ago, like probably 10, 12 years ago. I was like, I'll give this a go. And afterwards, like, this is great. Because after I finish work, I'm like, I can do whatever the fuck I want.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have to, because before you come home, you don't need to, you know, back in the day, when, like, I think now that I'm old, I'm fatter, I'm balder, I'm grayer, I'm like, I'm married, fuck it. You know, I don't need to look sweet anymore. Whereas when I was younger, I was a bit more vain. I was like, I need to look sweet. You know, you could go out on the pool the weekends. You're living for the weekends. I'm like, I have to get the gym in. Whoa. Whereas now, I'm like, fuck, whatever.
See, I never had that kind of thing of, like, I have to go to the gym to do all this stuff, because I never wanted to do that stuff.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean. I would much rather, like, when I was younger, I could probably count on, like, one hand how many times I've actually been to a nightclub.
On a nightclub?
Yeah. Like,
really?
So I'm not a huge fan. I would much rather sit in a pub. Like, I don't drink anymore, but when I was drinking, like, I would happily sit in a pub from like 6 to 1 a.m. And just, like, have a chat and stuff like that, a couple of pints, rather than go to a place where...
See, the dream for me is just all day drinking. Like, in a pub, sitting, the mates are there, you're having the crack, you probably have a spot of dinner, watching football. Home and bed, a reasonable hour.
That sounds, yeah. You that know, would be my, if I was going to have a stag weekend, that would be it. Like, maybe with a museum chucked in or something like that.
Like, well, that would be the worst ever. Like, true story, speaking about museums, on a stag do, a mate of mine was going on a stag do, and he was planning it, and he was like, oh man, we should fucking go to Poland and all. And he's like, oh, why? And he's like, fucking, let's go on, we can do this, and like, drinks cheap and all. And he's like, we need to do an activity during the day. And he genuinely goes to me, he goes, what about Auschwitz? And you know what I went? No, it's a fucking, absolutely fucking not. You name me something more disrespectful than a group of lads turning up. Oi, say hello at fucking Auschwitz. No, just absolutely not.
Just imagine the stag party t-shirts that you get.
Oh my God, you know, it's fucking terrible. You know, the rimmer just walking past the fucking mound of shoes. Like, so disrespectful. Do you know what I mean? You know, like, and he was like being serious, because he obviously went, Krakow, what's there to do in Krakow?
Yeah,
and
he's like, it's number one.
And then he would be like, but do you have friends who are really smart, like book smart, but have zero common sense?
Oh, yeah.
This guy. What we could do, we could go out, we could go on the beer bikes. We could get a beer bike to Auschwitz. I'm like, no, why don't we? No, don't. What are you doing? And he's just like, fucking up, big 69. Oi, oi. He'd be like, fuck, any chance this wrapping up? I need to get a pint. You know, it's wise up.
Yeah, it's weird. Like, I do, when I was doing improv comedy, like, before the pandemic and stuff like that, I was in a group of people, and I was the only one that didn't have a PhD. They're yeah. all like super intelligent people.
Like the qualification
people. But yeah, I was the only one that didn't have, like, wasn't Dr. Robinson or Dr. whatever. And
I mean, go legally, go to the change that by depot. Now, what a stand-up name, Dr. Robinson. Like,
I would change it to like Dr. yeah. Love or something like that.
Dr. Robinson. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Robinson. That'd work.
Should we like document this for a Patreon exclusive or something like
Dr.
that?
Dr. Robinson will go on stage and then Dr. Robinson. In fact, what's the Dr. Robinson? You will see Dr. Robinson now rather than mix it up. It would work. So your improv is smart, guys.
Like we were doing the improv festival down in Dublin and stuff like that, and trying to like corral all these very like intelligent people to try and get a train on time to get there and then walk to the place. It was like, I don't know, herding geese. Is that a sign?
Herding geese? I don't know. Is it like, I don't know.
I assume they're pretty hard to herd.
It would be tough to herd geese, I would say. Mm. Herding flies, there's a good one. But I again just made it up. But I haven't looked, also haven't looked at my hair before this point. I know it's not much of it, but I like it to
be sweet.
But that's the thing, is like in life you have to balance between being like a functioning person. Like you need book smarts and street smarts in the middle, you know. But a lot of people just don't have that. It's either one or other.
Yeah.
It's like you study all the time and mummy and daddy will give you some dough.
Yeah.
Or else you like get a job and you work out what it's like to have like because the amount of people that I've known who have been quite, you know, from well-to-do families and like quite well off. And people are probably like, excuse me, you're gripping everyone together here. How dare you judge people? You know, fuck up. It's a podcast. Fuck up.
Yeah,
right?
Fuck up.
So what I'm saying, like, these guys will then just go straight into, like, work, study, you know, do degrees, PhDs. They won't have to work. Mm. Then they'll, like, get into, like, a specific job where they haven't really met regular, normal people. Like, I remember one of my, first jobs was working in B&Q, and it was just everyone mixed together. It was class.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then when I went to start working in the housing executive, I met people like I'd never met. Like, just people who would say things that if you were to, like, you know, be a sheltered academic, you'd be like, that's offensive. You say that, and you're like, but yeah, it isn't. It may be the words may be offensive, but this guy's a 65-year-old joiner. Mm. You know what I mean? Things were different the way he was. Everyone can't be the way...
Yeah, you expect them to be. Yeah,
but that's mental the way the world is now.
Oh yeah, 100%.
Like even like I've noticed a wee bit more of a difference between myself and my sister. My sister would be 5 years younger than me, but we moved. So I would have been brought up in Hollywood. I'm not saying I'm gangster by any means, but listen, I'd have hung about the ghetto in Hollywood when I was younger.
There's a ghetto in Hollywood.
It's a ghetto. It's called a ghetto, and it's gatto actually. They just refer to the gatto down than the gatto. But like I would have had sort of, you know, would have had more, like my friends have been quite mixed from all different backgrounds, you know, whereas my sister would have had very, like, when we moved from Hollywood to Crawfordsburn when I was 17, so she was about 12 or 13, so she like was a bit more snobby because her like formative years, and even now she'd be a bit like, you know, I'd be like, why are you such a snob?
Yeah, that's the exact same with me and my brother, but we're only like 13 months apart.
Yeah,
so he's like spends every pick of money he has in like fancy clothes and shit like that.
Yeah,
and I dress like this.
Yeah, but it's a strange thing. I think like you need to have a balance, you know, of like that's the thing too. I don't think schools teach you enough like life things, you know, like home economics. Change it, you know. Change it,
keep it, or change what you teach in it.
No, keep home economics, but change the syllabus.
Yeah, I want to learn how to do taxes. I don't care about making fajitas.
Teach things like that. Teach how to like stitch a wee hole in like a jumper or something. What I mean, like teach how to do things like that. Teach how to like book a holiday, you know, teach how to book accommodation flights,
how to get a solicitor, those kind of things, like
life insurance. Teach how to like get that ball rolling. Teach how to start like mortgage advice, you know what I mean, like careers, like what the fuck do you need that for?
Are you the type of person, I'm still like this, and I think it's an immature side of me, where I fucking hate ringing up and talking to people on the phone if I'm doing, like, have to arrange an appointment with a doctor or, like, dentist or something like that.
What age are you?
29.
29, right? I'm 35, so I think there's a slight gap there. And I think maybe because, again, with my sister, she'd be 30 now. She will not... But, like, my sister has a good job. Like, she's the best job in my family, like, you know, in terms of like on paper jobs. Now, I would say I have the best job because I get to entertain you guys and it's a pleasure. But in terms of like dough, she earns big dough and has a, you know what you say is a poor job. She would like have staff that would have to answer to her and whatever else. But she cannot book, can't phone, couldn't order a pizza.
Mm. You know, I'm professional at that.
Yeah, but like she wouldn't pick up the phone to anyone, doctors, yeah. anything. My mum would still do it for.
Yeah.
And I'm like, but why? You know, it's yeah. like, and the same thing, like if, you know, she has any issues with work or whatever, she would come in and be like, oh, I can't say it to them. And it's like, she's a mouthpiece to us. I'm like, just bring that energy to there. You'll be grand. You know, but I think it's definitely a thing. And as time goes on, like, I would be a big phone call, like a big ringer of people. If I want something done and he's done now, ring somebody.
Yeah, don't wait around for a text.
Whereas people will be like, text and email. And it's like, that side's really starting. And that's just the way of...
Are you a voice note guy?
I'm starting to become a voice note guy.
Yeah, I found myself kind of transitioning into that way of life.
Because I think, like, a lot of time... And I mean, I think it's the nature of what we, it's so scattergun that you're like, right, can you do a podcast in, like, today? And I said to you, do you want to do a podcast 11:30 at, like, 10 to 12? And you're like, yeah, sweet. So then on that, like, you were like, do you want a coffee? I'm like, I'm driving here, so I can't, like.
Oh, yeah, it's super handy when you're driving.
By the way, here, you know, and that's what I would have found. And then if there's some stuff you want to say, you don't want people screenshotting as well, you go, listen.
Exactly.
But, you know, I think that's the way of it. But, like, people would almost be awkward. Like, I was thinking about house phones recently. Mm. Like, I just don't have a house phone.
Yeah, we don't have one in the house.
You know, and it's like, back in the day, that was...
the only way you can contact people.
The go-to. Like, I was in my folks the other week, and their house phone rang, and it was like, what the fuck? I haven't heard of that. And it was like an Amazon guy looking, you know, for the right house. They're just on the phone. Are you number 7, mate? No, mate, we're not. Ah, Balix. Bye. And it was like, just, but it was still, when it rang, it startled us.
Mm.
I just think that's, because again, some people, I mean, I just want to point out here, obviously... some people think whenever you're on podcasts, what you say is just your opinion. They neglect the fact this is an entertainment show. That's what it is. Some people are like, oh, listen, no fucking old man complain about stuff. I'm 35. Things are different now than the way they were whenever I was coming to. So, yeah, I'm going to spot that out. You know, I'm going to talk about that. I spoke about influencers and people took umbrage about it. But, hey, shouldn't wear bum bags around your shoulders. That's what I'm saying.
That's a hot take. I can't wait for Dave's hot takes.
You know, it's like, fucking people. I just, and I mean, like, they're like, oh, listen to you and all. It's like, well, it's my opinion. Why should I have to,
exactly,
you know, change it? And the point is, I'm okay if they're not being a phone, but it is weird. And, like, stuff, the way you notice things are changing. Like, I couldn't be without WhatsApp.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But I remember before it. You know, I remember, like, if you wanted your mates to come around, you'd have to, like, ring them. I remember the very early stages of, like, wanting to ask a girl out.
Mm.
You'd have to ring their house and speak to their, like, mum or dad first. You'd have to pray. You'd be like, I would ring you this evening, damsel. Be beside the phone awaiting. I don't want to speak to your parents. And then she'd be like, but what if I'm on the toilet? And it's like, but you're a girl. You don't go to the toilet. You know? And then you'd be ringing. And you'd be like... is it you? You go, who the fuck says? Oh, no. I need to speak to your daughter. What the fuck are your intentions of my daughter? And it's like, a blue job. No.
I'm
going to take it to the cinema, you know?
I am so glad I bypassed all that shit.
Oh, fuck, it's terrible. And I'd be like, you sound like a wee dickhead and all. And you're like, oh, well, I'm not. Honestly, I'm one of the good guys. But that was the fuck. Imagine doing that now.
Oh, man.
And even worse, imagine you're just early stages with a girl and maybe like you had maybe 2-3 dates. It went well. Third date, not so good. You're trying to phone up to be like, here. And then she's been like, oh, I thought, and then the dad has a wee bit of, he's got a wee bit of a prejudged opinion of
you. Yeah.
The fuck, you fucking me. Like, see me, I very much will be this dad. You upset my daughter, did you?
Yeah.
You fuck, and I have this ability. It's like, I can go from being like banter Dave to like, and like, I mean,
deadpan.
Like, deadpan, I mean, see, like my job for years was knocking people's door to be like, you commit antisocial behavior. And I had like a whole facade almost that have to go in and be serious with people. And like, again, I rely on my physical appearance a lot to people. And whenever I'm like, this is not good enough. You're not getting the head. And it happened to me once. I thought I was going to have to go there again. The way I've said on the podcast before, there's a family that live out the back of our house, and listen, this is going to be these three young kids, and I'll go, he's at it again. But they, like, have house parties, and, like, it's fine. I've been to house parties. I know what it's like. I used to party back in the day.
Yeah, there's tequila in that cold brew.
Yeah, I was going to say, it actually tastes like brandy. Yeah. What an episode that would be. Imagine I just got off my dick on tequila that day and then drove home. But hey, listen, comedians shouldn't drink and drive. Oh, you know,
definitely it's, shouldn't. It's stupid.
But that particular case was the maybe a few months, maybe about a year ago, probably last summer, they had a party, right? And yeah, it would have been last summer because my baby was only wee, like wee. And she was not sleeping well.
So is this like where you were living or was this
yeah,
when
where
you were
I live.
Working?
This is where, the, I, oh, this is where okay. I live.
Okay.
And like, so we were there. And this is a sign of times and how I'm old as well, parts of the story. So I'm there, right? And then it's a loud party and you're coming up like 8, 9 o'clock. You're like, kids will be, you know, not worrying about it. Yeah, it's coming up to 10. You're like, don't worry about it. Because again, and then this is my ASB head because I know when it passes 11, that's when you can phone noise control or the police. And I was like, here. And I'm sitting, coming half 10. I'm like, you have half an hour. I was counting down, like 10:59. And you're like, clank. It's like, and if it didn't stop. And for whatever reason, my blood pressure boiled. And then my wife, Catherine, was like, you may tell him, knock it off, the baby's awake. And I was like, oh no. And then I'm like, I'm not going to go around to their house. Cause, and then nowadays, I'm like, they might have knives. Kids these days,
yep.
They might have knives.
They'd be packing,
you know,
knives.
Probably where we live, you know, there'd probably be fish knives, you know, tartar sauce knives. But I said, no, I'm not going around. And then the most, you know, the emasculating sentence your wife can say to you is, well, if you don't go around, I'll go around. And you're like, well,
man,
for fuck's
sake, I can imagine that.
Like, I'm going to have to go around then, aren't there? There's no fucking other way I can get out of this. So I was like, right, okay, I'll do it. Now, on the side note, this is where the technology comes into play. The street WhatsApp groups started popping off.
Oh,
yeah.
Fuck.
So there are other people being like, have you reported this to the PSNI? And it's like, and again, this guy's like, I haven't rang it, but I've reported the email. And I'm just reading it going, I got put into the group as banter. Because I said to my wife, like, you be in the group. I don't want him to do that. See any like school kids groups, any of that. You just tell me, you handle it. Whatever,
that's
I'll not be
thing.
In it.
Yeah, that's your realm.
Yeah, look, I mean, I don't want to be there because, again, this is going to sound a bit wanky in some extent, but whenever people know you're a comedian or whatever, they expect the banter.
Oh,
whenever
yeah.
you're just,
yeah.
like, in serious moments, you're like, I don't want to always have the banter. Like, I got outed in my group chat there with when the BLAP came out. Someone's like, we saw your BLAP, Dave, sent the link in and all. Tremendous. And everyone's like, oh, you do comedy? An old French teacher of mine, all, oh, really? You? No, it's like, oh, yeah, awkward. But so this party's all going on. They're all knocking. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to have to knock a door.
Mm.
So I end up getting myself psyched up. And I actually put a costume on, you know? Like, I dressed like I look intimidating. So I went and I put, like, a black coat on, zipped it right up, put black gloves on and a black hat. And I walked around, and as I was walking around, because their house is like backing on, so it was a different street, but backing on doors, and right where the baby's window is. So I was like walking around, getting myself psyched. It was almost like, you know, like you ever see Andy Serkis, the actor, when he gets into like Gollum, and he gets all like into the mo. As I was walking around, I was like, I could feel like my spine stretching. I'm like getting bigger and puffing my chest out and getting angry. And I was like, what am I going to say here? So I went in and knocked on the door. And there's no answer, and I could hear the party really blaring. Like, and that was the thing. The music was really loud, and it was vibrating through the whole fucking street. It was wild. And then knocked the door again. And again, back in my day, I'm like, I would have partied, but if someone came and told me, I would shit myself.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
So, like, I'd be like, I'm sorry. So, I battered the door until my hand was sore. Mm. And, like, a young girl. Now, these kids are probably 17, 18, maybe 6. To me, she looked 8, right? Came to her. I was like, who owns the house? Mm-hmm. And like the voice and all, I was like, Liam Neeson, who owns this house? And then she like said, and that was another thing it did that was even scarier. COVID was kicking off still at the time, so the mask on.
Oh.
So the mask, and a mask, the gloves, the hat, you could only see my eyes. And I like fucking raging. And then the guy came to the door, he's like, hey, and I was like, and I went so deadpan, and I said something that was such a scary threat. I was like, mate, you're going to turn that music down, and you're going to turn it down now, because if I have to come back to this house, I'll not be knocking the door.
Oh,
and then I walked away and I was like buzzing. I was like, this feels great. And I was like, I thought I'm just gonna start, like, I thought I'm just gonna join the paramilitary and start putting people out, you know, just for hobby.
I cannot wait to see this Belfast Live article.
And it was like, so then that was a year ago and it had been fine. And then last the weekend there, I was like, it started again, and I was like, this time I'm gonna have to like start hitting. I'm just gonna have to start knocking out kids.
Yeah.
Like, see that like gif that's going about the guys slapping people at a party? I was like, that's just, I'm gonna, that's my next move if they don't. But then, you know what I thought? Because at this time, Catherine was in bed, so she was asleep, the kids were asleep. The only thing was, my oldest kid, 4-year-old, woke up and came out of her room, said, "Daddy," and I was like, "Shh, get in the bed, don't wake anyone else, go to sleep." And then I thought, you know what I'm gonna do, because I could feel like the blood in me going boom, boom, man, it's like I'm getting fucking angry here, but there's no WhatsApp messages, so it wasn't kicking off in the street. And then this time around, because I got no thanks for it in the street WhatsApp group, so if I'd have got thanks, I'd have gone, "Listen, you're here, let me just get the gear on and go around again."
Exactly.
Because I got no thanks, I'm like, you know what, fuck you guys.
Yeah.
So if anyone had said, I said, "Listen, I'm not going around because I went around last time."
Yeah.
But
exactly, that's your out.
But then I just went into my bed, because I mean, we're at the front of the house, the kids are at the back, so they would be the one disturbed. And I went to sleep and I didn't hear it. And the next morning I was like, that's okay. Because I thought, like, but what I will do, and this is so low-key bitch for me, when I see the guy's mummy who owns the house, I'm going to go, like, this is when you know you're a full-grown adult. You have to go, you need to have a word of your kids. Because, like, they must have a big fucking subwoofer, because the whole street was like, and it was like
vibrant.
Yeah, and then the dog went out for a pee before bed, and he wouldn't pee, he was too scared because the noise was, and I was like, see if he pisses
in my
kitchen.
That's where I draw the fucking line.
See if you piss in my kitchen, I swear I will piss in your face. That's my problem with that. I think that is genuinely a problem that I have, like, my need for vengeance. Like, I will store the need for vengeance, and it'll lie dormant in me for could potentially be years. Like, I could hold a grudge for years, and when the opportunity for vengeance arrives, just I will take it. I will strike. You know, and I was going to actually put a thing up on Twitter. I thought it was really funny. It was like, you know, Liam Neeson, the picture of him on the phone.
Aye.
And I was going to be, there's kids having a party at the back of my house, and I'm going to be like this, and then put the picture up, and then underneath it was going, right, I'm not actually going to, you know, threaten them or anything, or go around, that's me on the phone with the PSNI. And I was like, guys, listen, there's a party here, it's too excessive, I don't want to go around. But yeah, and that's the annoying thing, because when I was a child, I'd say teenager, I was annoying. Like, I loved the party.
Oh, yeah?
Loved to drink, loved to be fucking... And then nowadays, a bit of me's like, I can't really get that annoyed.
I've always been that kind of, like, grumpy old man where I just don't like house parties. I used to live...
I loved them.
Do you know where the Cloisters, like, apartment complex in the Holy Lands is?
Yeah.
So it's for...
Apartment complex? Complex.
Complex.
Yeah.
It is very complex.
It would give you a fucking complex living near that. Jesus Christ.
So, it was for, like, young professionals who are there working. It's not, like students
from,
and stuff
it has
like
to
that.
Be from out of town, though.
Oh, yeah, yeah. They're all from, like,
no
Dungannon and
going to be like, fuck, hey, this is some queer complex here, no? And they're like, fuck me. So were you in there living?
So I was in there living with a guy from Derry and a guy from Strabane.
Okay.
And they all had jobs, like, 9-to-5 kind of things. They were all, like weren't partying that much or anything like that. But there was only one set of students that lived there.
Yeah.
And they lived in the apartment directly above us, which was bad. Yeah. So we moved in, and they moved in like a couple of weeks before us. So there's a couple of times where we'd all like meet in the living room and go like, someone needs to go up and say something.
Yeah.
And like, I was never the guy. I'm too retiring to be that kind of guy. But the guy from Strabane was like, no, fuck it, I'll do it. Like, literally, he was happy to do it. So this one time, like, fucking middle of the night, we had to get up for work the next morning.
Oh, no.
Fucking raging. Jack literally walks up in his boxers, raps the door.
Yeah.
And he goes like, right, I swear to fuck, I will rip the electrical fucking wires out of the wall if you guys don't fuck up. And so they turned it down, which was weird because the noise level went down, but the vibrations went up. So I don't know if they just like... put the bass up and then turn the volume down or whatever. But that was like the only real kind of interaction I had with him, apart from one day went out for a smoke in the morning. I think I was hungover at this point because I was in a really, really fucking bad mood.
Yeah.
And this like freight like lorry comes in and is backing up, and the guy comes out to me with a docket and he goes like, here, I've got a pallet for you.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, who's it for? And it was like, oh, the apartment above us.
Yeah.
They ordered a pallet of WKDs. A pallet.
Mm-hmm.
So like, you're looking, what, 48 boxes or something like that of like, I don't know, blue WKD or whatever
respect.
It was.
Fair respect.
And I was just like, it's not for me, it's for them upstairs.
Yeah.
So he goes there, and I'm out in my dressing gown having a smoke, and they're coming out of their fucking cave, like proper hungover, just going like, oh man, I'll give you a box if you help me move these up the stairs. And I never spoke to those people again.
Yeah, no. Well, see the thing, the boxer story, that happened, that was the first time I'd ever gone to people before. I was living in a house off Lisburn Road, and there's a group of students in the house beside us. Now, we, in the last couple of years, it was that we had three girls in there, mm-hmm. and they were like angels. You know, they just were grand. You know, and we sort of would speak to them a bit, and it was all grand. So it was me and a few other fellas living in the house. And at this time, I remember I had a job interview the next day, and they had this full blown party, and like they were doing like stomping, and the whole house was shaking. And it was like, I don't know what it is, but like I can go, my anger can just, I can lose it right. And then it's like the adrenaline just makes me do something. So I was lying in bed being like, right, let it go, let it go, let it go. And then for whatever reason, it just wouldn't stop. And I just went, right, fuck this, straight up in my boxers, knocked it. Again, not knowing what I'm saying, but I said something along the lines of, see if you do, I will murder, like, I will murder every single one of these. I will shove the radio. And whatever happened, they stopped the noise. And like, I would have probably, they would have been students that had been a few years older. I'd probably been like 24 or something at the time. And like, not a peep out of them ever again. And then one night we were out drinking, and this is the only reason I remember it, because it was the night I drank two bottles of Buckfast. And I was in the backyard just in great spirits, you know. I come in, I was on my second bottle of Buckfast, haven't, so drank one before I went out, went for a whole lot of drinking, came back to the house, thought, ah, fucking crack another bottle. Was just out sitting out the back, one of my mates was having a smoke, we were just having a chat, and I heard them out the back, and I heard one go, shit, fuck, he's there, be quiet. And I went, well, boys, over the fence. And they were like, what? And I was like, listen, I just want to say, you know, cheers for keeping, you know, I might have been a wee bit OTT that time, you know. And he was like, oh yeah, he's like, oh, you're actually not that. I was like, you know, not that monster, I mean, I'm quite sound. But I mean, genuinely, from the bottom of my heart, if you do think this is me saying you can no, I will, I'll still murder you, but I'll be civil in between.
I'll,
you know,
be sound about it.
Yeah. Like. And he's like, oh, you drink Buckfast? And I was like, this is my second bottle. And probably, he's a psycho, this guy. Now, what I will say, people is, dude, that's what I am scared, though, of that stuff as well, because...
What, Buckfast?
Yes, no, I am, totally. Like, because I think I haven't drank a bottle of Buckfast probably in 7 or 8 years now, like, but I used to fucking love this stuff, and like,
never had it. I've had like a taste.
It wouldn't be good for you now.
Oh, definitely.
No, it wouldn't be good for you.
Not.
But like, having worked with antisocial behavior cases, see, whenever, and like, you could probably say like people, like maybe the people I was went the door off were probably like people partying, drinking, normal enough people. But there are some people who, like, that I've dealt with, who have genuinely, like, mental health, serious mental health problems, drug and alcohol issues. You know, you don't know what you're going to. So it's like, a lot of time you're like saying to the neighbours, don't go around there, report it to us, you know, because you don't know what. And there was a case, one of our tenants was murdered from a neighbour from antisocial, like, and he stabbed to death. And it was like, fuck. You know, and that's like, and you can see, though, why, if that was continuing. Like, I lost the rag on isolated nights, and I got so angry. But imagine every single fucking minute of every day, it would do your head in.
Oh yeah, no, 100%.
You know, and like, and I think it's like, it's absolutely, but then whenever that person, that was a real, like, fuck, that is,
that's, know, terrifying.
Like. But there are people out there, like, genuinely how some people are living is scary. You know, I don't think, obviously, we could get into the whole fucking mental health pandemic that we have here as well, but like, some of the people, you're like, they're just not the help for them. And then you just be like, oh, stick yous into this house here, and then you put them beside the road. You know, like, you can see why situations could,
yeah, just burst up like that.
Could escalate. Like, well, no, I mean, I'm not going to go into this, I'll probably get fucking in trouble about it, but I remember there was a guy who got a house somewhere, who he was came from a different area into the area that we managed at the time. But this is back probably 10 years ago again now, and he, and like, nowadays everything's online, so like, you can go onto the system and you can see what the notes are of everybody, whether someone's suited to you, whatever. On this particular case, this guy had been given an offer of the housing before like his hard file had got to our office, so he had already been offered, he had signed for it and all. File comes from another district, and it's like that big. This guy's like just out of like a mental health unit after like 10 years. So he shouldn't be in a house by himself. He needed assisted living. And he got put into like a real tough area. And it was like, you know straight away the powers that be in areas are not going to like this. And then like, there was a bit of an issue there. And then the powers that be were like, he needs to go. And then my job at the time was like, well, you know, he needs assistance. I'll liaise with his care workers and stuff, and you know, he's got these, you know, he's not with it mentally, don't be going and putting them out, basically.
Yeah.
And they're like, right, okay, we'll see what the crack, we'll leave it with you. And then it was fine for a bit, then he got a girlfriend who was also you know, vulnerable, and it was like just a whole shit show. They started having a dig a match. Then he ended up in the street one day, and he said to some girl, I was like 13, you know, do you want to come to my house for a party? Her dad, well-known guy, and he was like, I'm going to murder him. And I was like, fuck. And so then the whole thing was like, they came back being like, he's getting put out, and he's getting put out today unless she's getting him out. So I had to have to then go and try to like work with him and his social worker to be like, you need to go somewhere. And I had to say to the social worker, you need to support, like, support that he needs supported housing, because because it's like a duty of care thing. It's like, yeah, you can stay there and be like, it's only a threat, but you know, if it's acted on, look, God forbid, he could be, you know. And as much as, you know, he was a total fucking disaster and a nightmare to deal with, you don't want to see anyone get physically hurt. But then that was such a shit show, and then I ended up having like a complaint letter about me being like, you made him homeless and all. And I was like, well, you could have stayed, but you know, then it would have been my fault that he was fucking homeless with no legs. You know, it's like, what do you want to, you have to balance it. And then, you know, I think he is now, before I left, I sort of, someone, I was speaking to a colleague I worked with, and they were like, yes, he is in like a supported housing, which, and he's doing well. And that's the sort of thing you need. Certain people just need a bit more assistance with things, and it's but yet it's so easy to just, you know, put people in places and just leave them to it. It's wild.
Yeah, just the easiest kind of solution kind of thing.
Yeah, but it's scary, and that's the thing with antisocial behavior. You just, you know, report it. Like, this is anyone listening, don't go around. You know, I went around to like 17-year-olds, no one, okay, fuck it all. I'm sorry. Like, you know, it's like little, like it's like 1,000 chickens. I stomp on all their heads, grand. But don't you, if you don't know what you're going to, don't go around.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like Marvin Gaye.
Yeah, what happened to him? His dad killed him.
Dad shot him. Yeah, fucking. You know, that's absolutely nothing to do with that. I thought it was the first person I thought who knocked at the door and shot them. Just Marvin Gaye's dad. Hey, daddy, bang. Fuck up.
Oh, the day after Father's Day, too.
I know. Was it?
Well, no, today is. Yeah, today is.
Fuck, I was going to say, like, did he do that?
Research this. Here, remember we did that? Was an episode for Patreon about the, like, serial killers?
Yes.
What was the serial? Like, because the whole thing was you gave a serial killer for a certain person.
Yes.
What was the one you gave me? Was it Robert Picton, because the whole pig thing?
Yes, yeah, it was Robert Picton.
I couldn't remember.
But
couldn't,
you know what? That's something that, again, any Patreon listeners, it's there on Patreon if you want to go and have a look. I did a thing called Serial Killing It. It was a podcast over Zoom with get comedians on and sort of link a comedian for as whatever random reason to a serial killer, and that was why. But I love doing serial killing podcasts and stuff, but it just didn't click, because in the end, like, it was fine to do it with you because you have an interest in it, 'cause you're a weirdo like me.
Oh yeah.
But like some people, you're almost like, you know, I think I had like a Sean Hegarty on, and I think he was on, and I was on like, do you ever hear about the serial killer Ted Bundy? And he's like, nah, who's that? And I'm like, well, I mean, if you don't know,
yeah, does he not have Netflix?
Yeah, but that's the thing. It's like, it's such a specific thing that if people don't have a knowledge of it, it's just you reading Wikipedia to them.
True,
you know.
True.
So like, I found like that was a problem, that like people are like, it's just you reading Wikipedia to certain people you don't know about serial killers, and so if I could find a format, I would bring it back for a wee limited series and just get people in,
man,
here,
the dream,
and you know, do that, because it was fun.
Yeah, I think there's also like a hierarchy, because I think if you look at the like trends in like popular podcasts to do, like in the realm of comedy, there's a fucking lot of true crime podcasts and stuff like that. And I think,
but I mean, Stag did Auschwitz, that could be, you know, one. Yes. Hi, welcome to Eastern Europe. Imagine how long that would last. All you would hear is the introduction, people would be like, get this guy cancelled. Guys, welcome to Stag did Auschwitz. Here we are. This day, what we're going to do.
Surely that's the end of the episode today.
I mean, algorithm? No. Mr. Gorithm will be like, Dave, no, not today.
Not today. No. Satan.
I think it's going to be Future Guy. That's what this is called. Yeah. But yeah, the Stag did Auschwitz, that was a genuine. Let's do it, lads. It'll be what his justification was. He goes, well, I mean, we would need a drink after that. And I'd be like, well, we'd also, no. Yeah. No, there's no
way.
Is
there no like mini golf or something you could go to instead?
But then what I think we did was went to Prague instead. We're just like, we'll go to Prague. Yeah, fuck it.
So our concentration camps in Prague?
Probably. They're all kicking around those parts.
Imagine you guys going to Prague and he just gets like a really obscure like concentration camp or World War II kind of memorial.
Like, there we are, lads. Hey!
It's like he doesn't want to get married to get married. He just wants a stag party to thing.
What a juxtaposition that is. But like, even when we went to another stag, dude, Amsterdam, there weren't like let's go down Frank's house. The same guy's like, let's see it. Let's just get a vibe for it. Let's go down Frank's house, steaming and high as fuck.
No. That's the way it's supposed to be interpreted.
Yeah, and one of my mum's friends, actually, we went for dinner with my dad's birthday a few months back, and he was like, I have never done drugs before. And listen, I was in Amsterdam, and I thought, why not? He's like, I'm there with my partner. Two of us are there. We're having a nice time. Let's get a brownie. And he was like, okay. So it was his last day. And he genuinely had gone to see the Anne Frank house that day. And then he was like, yeah, we'll go have something. So he went and he had a brownie. And was like, it's giving him no feeling, nothing. Mm. And then he finished it. And then later on the night.
The whole thing?
Yes, the whole thing. But later on the night, he was like, it was weird because all of a sudden I was just like, out, and I just started getting this real weird feeling, and I was like, what was the feeling? He was like, I started believing I was Anne Frank. And I was like, what? And he was like, yeah. And like, see, when I could hear like lorries and all, I thought, oh shit, they're coming for me and all. And he's like, I was whiteying and like telling people that I was Anne Frank. And he was like, I was panicking and all. So then he said, they brought back to the hotel room, and he said he ended up like getting wrapped in the bed sheets, and his partner just went on out for like a few pints and left him there. But he was like, I was fucking freaking out, and I was like, my mind was going wild, and I'm like, they're gonna get me, and I couldn't move, and I was like, they're gonna get me. And he's like, I was probably doing the heading of all these people. And then he said that was fine. After that, he went to sleep, woke up the next day. And then they were heading out, like for lunch or whatever the next day, and thought, last day we'll have a wee drink, you know, just before we go on the plane. And he said, I had a drink of beer, and then he's like, it started hitting me again. He's like, I'm becoming an again. And he was like, I was chatting to people in Barcelona, and they're like, it's like, what do you do? And he's like, this guy's like, oh, I don't know, my name's Dennis. And I'm like, an accountant. He goes, what's your name? I'm Anne. And he's like, tell people he was Anne Frank. And he's like, well, what do you do? And he's like, oh, I'm an author. And all that. His partner's like, no, fuck that, get away, you've had too much.
What do you do? I'm a professional hide and seeker.
But it was like, the way he was telling me that story was one of the funniest things I'd ever met. And he was and he was so sincere. He was like, I just became a man. Like, it was like, and then it was like, it's just coming over me. It's like that rage with the neighbours. I was like, it's just the same thing. I become an man. And I said to him, listen, I'm going to steal that.
that's
a bit for me.
That
for
is
sure.
A bit. Fuck.
But it was just so funny. But I've like, stag dudes are great. Have you ever been a stag dude?
Not like a proper one. I went to one. So I have a friend. It was the same guy from Strabane who went up to the people in the boxers. But
he was in the boxers.
Oh yeah, he was in the boxers.
I mean, what neighbors? Vice versa. Yeah, like, that sounds like something like Stranger Things. They spoke to the people in the boxers. Yeah.
He lives over in England.
Yeah.
So he had one over in England and then one over in Derry.
Yeah.
With all his family from there. And I kind of lined it up with gigs that I was doing in Derry. Right, okay. So I went.
Oh, and sneaky.
I think I ended up doing two gigs that night because one of them was in Castle Derg, and then the other was in the Brickwork in Derry.
Yeah.
And they were on a stag do and like a couple of other bars in Derry. So I was like, oh, this is perfect. But it was very much like a normal day for me because all I was worrying about was the gigs. Yeah. And then I just ended up hanging out with them at the end.
Yeah, no,
so
I was
very
always,
chill.
No,
very chill.
All stag do's I've been horrendous.
Yeah.
Wild. Yeah. Amsterdam, Prague, Lisbon.
Lisbon.
Oh, no, I wouldn't go to Lisbon. We'd love their money. Oh, pay me to go to Lisbon.
What is it with the traffic? Like, I don't get it.
What is it with Lisbon, generally speaking?
Mm.
Speaking of which, let me see. Right, okay. Listeners' questions, because I know you have to.
Yeah, shoot on.
Places to go, people to see. He's actually going. He's going to Krakow.
Specifically.
Get the pints in and to go to Auschwitz. Oren has asked, if Tom Smith asked you to become, or this is, I'll take this directed to me. If Tom Smith asked you to drop comedy tomorrow and become his assistant, his business partner, would you do it? No, I wouldn't, because I enjoy comedy too much. But listen, could he persuade me? Probably.
He seems like a quite charismatic guy.
Listen, the guy's charismatic. He's focused. He's determined. And, you know, he speaks with such genuine positivity. I reckon he could convince me. You know, I reckon he could convince me.
If he was on that stag party, they would all be going to Auschwitz.
I mean, oh, I could do so much with this. Oh my God. But I think he would sue me. Imagine how emotive. How did he be like, listen, winners, like you. Oh my goodness. I'm not going to say anymore. But he's the only man that could convince me bringing a stag dude to Auschwitz would be a good idea. And then hopefully help me deal with the inevitable backlash that would follow. You know, when you're posting stories and all, fucking hell. Naomi Mitchell has said, she just makes statements and then sends me stories, okay? So there's definitely something that would have been a giveaway, and the story is, oh no. I was conned by my husband for 10 months. He turned out to be a woman. Now, I have a problem with this automatically.
Okay.
Because I hate anyone that's not heterosexual. No. No, I just think that, like, you don't just get married. You know, there's...
There's a...
So, like, the 10 months of being married's not the con. Like, what's happening before that? Like, the curtain stage?
Yeah.
As a fucking somebody born in 1948 would say.
The curtain.
Yeah. A woman's take... I mean, here's the thing. This is the thing I have a major umbrage with. A woman is taking the social media.
Yeah.
Why? Why does she just not take the social media? Yeah. Why should she not just tell her mates? You'll never believe us.
Yeah, exactly. Fucking
Garnet, weird first thing that comes to my head. Garnet doesn't have a piece on him. Garnet, here, you'll never believe us. I went to give Garnet a surprise beecher on his birthday. And he's got a minge. Ah, fuck's sake, Garnet, what are you at? A new bride said she was conned by her husband as 10 months into their marriage she discovered he was actually a woman. The victim, who was referred to as N.A. in legal, we'll just say Nadine Armstrong, entered into a relationship with a man she met through online dating who's identified as, I'll say G.A., Garnet Armstrong. Garnet claimed to be a man who was trained surgeon and in the coal business.
That is an ambitious crossover.
Like, yes, I can get you doing certain jobs. Sorry, I'm a minor, but hey, I thought the skills were transferable. You know,
it's like when you're trying to narrow down what you want to do when you're in primary school. Yeah. It's like either surgeon or minor.
Yeah, the guy asked my 4-year-old, like, what do you want to be when you're older? And she'll go, police officer. I want to be a dancer. I want to be in the Paw Patrol. And then a new job she really loves, she goes, I want to turn on the lighthouse. She wants to go and turn on the lighthouses. That's a job. She's like, I want to turn on the lighthouse. Wow. And it's like, all right. And then I want to be a coal miner. I want to be a surgeon. So the man, Clay, who was a trained surgeon and in the coal business, and the pair got married in secret and moved away from her family. Over the course of the relationship, she claims that her family were conned out of 16 grand, and now the husband appeared at a district court in Indonesia. It doesn't really say what.
Yeah.
You know, Naomi, come on, the stories need to get straight in.
Up that game.
It's a secret wedding. But I want to know how he conned her here. With what did he use? I mean, I just want to know what he used.
Yeah, it sounds like a catfishing thing.
Yeah, I mean, a twat fish, I would say, because he's got a hidden valley there for sure. There's the episode named. But yeah, I mean, I think that's because I remember reading something about this before, but it wasn't married. It was just a girl had claimed to be a man, and then was just using like a strap-on. For sex, you know, like a real life. I mean, this is going to sound weird. I watched a video on YouTube the other week that's like, it was a guy testing. I don't know, maybe I'll just show you. It was a guy testing whether it was a dildo or a real penis going into his ass. Real penis or dildo test. I mean, this is a lot of fun, but yes, it's on YouTube, guys. Just Google our YouTube real dick versus dildo challenge. Why is everything a challenge? So hold on. So there's a guy. If you want to describe that,
okay. So we're in a. That is.
I'll get Ben to pop this up.
Huge dick. Whatever this is that's in my ass right now is substantial. The reason I think this is a dildo is because it's very hard. Like, it doesn't, there's no give to it. So
he's guessing where they are. Hold on.
Can I ask you this much?
Can I just say, will William Thompson not appear on any podcast? No,
William Thompson will appear on anything. Hold on.
Very real. I have to say, I enjoyed that one.
This is real dick.
Yeah. I feel Igor. Like, well, now I don't know what to trust because my intuition says that this is you. However, my track record is not great. I feel like you're also just fucking with me, so. But one of these is for sure your dick.
Possibly.
Oh my god.
Possibly.
Okay, I will say, I feel like this is your dick. This is your deck.
It is.
Way! Well, there we go. What a tremendous show. But that's, yeah, so that was what this woman was doing. So you can get really realistic dildos. You know, not all dildos are just how.
Yeah, not all dildos are created equal. Like,
no, but it's a great business to get into. So if you want to do a crossover, I suppose if you can be a surgeon and in the coal business, you could be, you know, a comedian and a dildo maker. Yeah. Like,
dildo ambassador.
I was going to say, what's the name of someone that makes a dildo? It's going to say it's like a knobbler, like a cobbler. I don't know. right, next question. Anyway, John Joe said, watch Snoop Dogg's new comedy special on Netflix yet?
Yeah, I saw it advertised, but I didn't watch it. Like,
what are your thoughts in general on music and comedy combos? Would they work in NI?
It seems to be quite a popular thing. Like, yeah. Def Jam, they used to have, yeah, DJs, didn't they? Yeah. And shit like that.
Julian's cousin, Russell Simmons, set it up back in the day. Oh, was there gear in that? Like, oh, enough, I'm too giddy for this time in Monday. Oh. So anyway, no, yeah, do you think there's a crossover with...
Yeah, I mean, like, fuck it. I don't know. I think it's because of, like... I don't know, Northern Irish music. They're like, think of
John Zoo. John Zoo and Brian Kennedy. That'd be
crossover. But
I mean, it's one I like to see. Black Lives Matter. You'd be like, oh, John's got a sweet voice. But no, I think this is something you as one of the new breed of comedians would say. Like, to me, sometimes I think it's like, you can just be funny.
Oh, yeah.
But like some people, I think now try to be super cool with comedy and all. And I think as soon as you realize being a comedian's not cool, the better.
I think this is probably one of the strong points of my act. I, in no way, shape, or form, come across as cool.
Yeah. I mean, I come on and fucking wearing trainers and I'll be like, see my children, the bastards. But it's like, I think some people like the, but I think that comedy is this not cool.
Yeah.
You know, but I get like some music, like it's important for like walk-ons and things and like, you have to think about that for the set of vibe, I guess. But I don't know. I think like there's definitely a room for it. Again, when I saw Snoop Dogg at a comedy special, I went,
Dodd's nickname.
Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg. I mean, that would definitely liven up Stormont for sure.
Oh, 100%.
I would embrace him coming out of the Snoop Dogg. But I'm just gonna, we've done those questions, so we'll go on to Twitter now. So what do you think about
T-Dizzle.
It? Do you're quite into your music, aren't you?
Yeah, but I wouldn't say it's music that people like. I like.
Oh, listen to cool this guy. Man, so it's not mainstream stuff. You know, like the Smiths and the Cure. You know, whatever.
Yeah, I just listen to Korean trance music, and that's about it.
I just listen to Korean boy bands. K-pop.
Never, yeah, I never really got into K-pop.
Oh, no, I like K-pop too. It's like erasure, my all-time favorite, to be fair. But
I just like it because being a Crusaders fan, that's the anthem.
That's fair. That is fair. Oh, Sean and Neil left Crusaders this week.
Ballymena.
Yeah, friend of mine.
He's been away the past year at Ballymena. And
he's gone. Yeah. For good. You know, I'm actually wanting to get I want to get an ex-Crusaders player on the podcast. So do.
Get Jordan Owens on. I think that would be a good podcast, even though he's still playing. Like,
yeah, well, maybe see. He's a top legend.
Yeah.
Why did I sound like somebody that is a fan of Korean music? He is top legend. right, let's get on to the Twitter questions. Like, oh, that was a lot of fun. Brock has said, Brock, this is a good question, Brock. If Netflix approached you to make a documentary, what would you choose as the topic?
Is this dildo real or not?
And you'd be the primary tester. That would be so in left field. You'd be like, this is what...
Yeah, but through trick photography, I would be the guy testing.
Photography. I mean, like, I think that's something that would be, like... Yeah, how could you do it? Well, I don't know if you're I don't know, I've never seen your penis before, so could you bend it into your own ass? Could you strap a dildo? Could you strap three dildos onto your real dick and then they could all bend backwards and someone just put them in like fucking Dennis Taylor or something? Is that? And see?
There's only one way. I guess.
If anyone wants to commission us to make a cockumentary, get in touch. We will. In fact, is there a Rory Woods potion in this? Because I should be the pun man today. You've drugged me with something. I like it. And Pete Giffen has said that's a great question. And it is. I mean, realistically, other than is it cock real or fake, what do you what would you choose to be your topic of your documentary? I think your life could be, because you've had a queer old life.
Like, yeah, it's
you've had a very interesting story. But like, I would like to know more. That's what I've said to you before. I said I want to know more about the real you on stage, and want you to tell us some more. Because please tell people what you did when you were in Australia.
It was the first time
please
in Australia.
Tell me this as a job.
I worked in, so technically the place that I worked for was like a security place, kind of like G4S.
Yeah.
But
I mean, it wasn't in Conswater or anything.
No, it wasn't in Conswater in the Surfers Paradise. It was, so there's a law in Australia that all male pathologists, I think they've changed it now to all pathologists, no matter what gender.
For now, pathologists, it's not somebody who like builds roads.
No.
Want to explain what a pathologist is?
It is someone who conducts autopsies.
Correct.
So, and they find out the cause of death and stuff like that, if there's any kind of mystery surrounding the whole thing.
And the reason for your job is to make sure the pathologists don't go, is this a real tick or is it a dildo?
I supervise that to make sure that doesn't go on.
But are you like an adjudicator? It would be in a driving test. Like, do you have a clipboard to be like, yeah, he didn't touch their genitals? Because there's all these like urban myths, isn't there, about like people getting like lice in their pubes, and it's like these lice only live on corpses.
Yeah,
you know,
that,
it's like people shagging corpses and all. I mean, that's a gross phrase that I'm sorry that I use there, shagging corpses. So disrespectful. But was that a problem for a while, or why did that rule have to come about? Because there would have been a reason for it.
So for a rule to be made, there had to be people breaking it. That's what I kind of think.
Yes.
So I don't know, I guess. For me, it wasn't really that bad. Like, you're not seeing like everything get like torn open or anything like that. You're just there like supervising. So essentially I was listening to podcasts while it was happening and stuff like that, and the guy, like when you get told that there's an issue here and this is your job essentially, just to supervise this, you think that all like the pathologists that you're going to meet are all like
creeps
perverts and stuff like that. But there's this one guy, and I'll not say his name because I forget it, but I was like, it was going in, and it was the first day I was working with him.
Was going and where
he was going in to perform the perform the autopsy, and turns out cause of death real dildo. I go in, and this is the first time I'm working with him. I may be in the job maybe like 7 to 10 days, something like that, and I'm expecting meeting this new guy. He's gonna be a fucking weird guy. He just turns around to me, he's in the break room, I walk in, and he's just eating out of a Tupperware thing. And he goes like, hey mate, do you want some chicken vaginas?
Yeah.
And for the life of me, thought he said chicken vaginas. Yeah. But it's just fajitas in an Australian
vaginas. Yeah, you want some fucking vaginas? Because if you want some, I'll cut you off a bit. I'll fucking cut you a sliver of any if you want it, mate. Just don't put that in your fucking forms, mate. Now you fucking get me struck off.
Yeah, he's from East fucking Australia.
But could you have banter? Were there ever like any banter pathologists?
Not
like,
really.
Could there ever be like, I cut an arm off, be like, do you like that, mate? And he'd be like,
he goes, good day's work. Shake your hand, it's not their hand.
Hey!
it's just a normal job. It's just like extreme circumstances, but it gets very normal very quickly.
Was there any of them where you were just like, that's affected me and I don't feel too good here?
No.
Wow, we'll get on the next question, because you're a sociopath.
Yeah, there's a reason.
Yeah. Owen has said, wrong show, but who's to blame for my flight to Edinburgh being cancelled this morning?
Okay, so I got I had like 3 flights to London, my flight there, my flight back, and then another one next week, all cancelled by EasyJet.
Apparently the reason behind that is layoffs of staff during COVID.
They didn't give any reason for him being cancelled or anything
not
like
good
that.
Enough.
Bad boys.
Yeah, not good enough. So we're going to blame, fuck it, may as well, Boris Johnson, he's to blame.
Fuck him.
Chris has said, this will be the last question, and I'll let you go to collect the children.
That's not a euphemism.
No, it literally is. Oh no. Other than Gaza and Ramote, which I find funny, what's been your best joke, topic, piece that you've been proud of and thought was going to be great but turned out to bomb? Yeah, he's talking about a bit. I did a bit about Ramote. And no, Gaza it was, and the war in Ukraine. Did I ever tell you this?
No, I was there.
Lafferty's, I ate so much shit. I thought it was so good. But then it turns out, like, the crowd in Lafferty's are all like young guys, and girls didn't know what happened.
Oh yeah, it's like realm milk.
So I was like, yeah, I come up with all these great wee like weapons and all that Gaza could have used. Like, I've got a bear trap, mate, you know, like all these wee niche things Gaza could have brought to the fucking Ukraine Russian border. And I was up there and I, you know, when you really bomb, you're like, I need to get out of this, and you should have just been confident in it and seen it through. But then my accent started going out, and I was like, what am I doing? Why is this my life?
You know? There's Alavery's a couple of months ago now, and I was getting on great, fucking loving it, just doing some stuff that I've been doing for a while, and I was like, at the end, I was like,
stag do it, Auschwitz, what now?
This is the perfect time to try new stuff right at the end.
Yeah.
Fucking die to death, like, because it was...
Do you know
was,
what are you going to do? Are you doing it
oh,
still?
Oh, I'm doing it still, because, like, a few of the guys...
Because you're a glutton for a punishment.
I really am. But it was about my mum getting gangrene. In 2022.
Fuck me. I'm glad you said green. I am so glad you said green. Because for a second, I thought that was going to be something else. Wow. Wow.
Oh, yes. Yeah. It absolutely died to death.
Good. I'm glad, because you nearly made me really uncomfortable. Guys, thank you for watching and listening. Jordan, do you have anything to plug? Where can people follow you? Where can they get you?
Jordan Robinson Comedy on Instagram and Facebook. I'm going out on a mini tour soon.
Nice.
Yeah, just look on Instagram.
Of Eastern Europe.
Hitting all the concentration camps. Yeah, just keep an eye on social media for that.
Yeah,
thanks for having me, dude.
Yes.
My dude. I'm the sly guy.